Georgia and this is The Sound of Georgia. And today we're back with another episode of Today in Julie Andrews History. And today we're going to be talking about Camelot. Camelot was the third stage musical Julie ever did. It opened 60 years ago at the Majestic Theatre on the 3rd of December 1960. But by the time the movie came out in 67, it was pretty much gone from the stage, having closed in 1963. But we'll talk more about the movie in a bit. After My Fair Lady's success, it was pretty much given that Lerner and Lowe would be doing another show. At the very beginning, they weren't all that successful, but Brigadoon was a hit, My Fair Lady was even bigger, so there had to be another one. And getting Julie back was no surprise. So it was the same gang as before. In addition to Julie, you've obviously got Lerner and Lowe. But Moss Hart is directing and Franz Eller was conducting and you get the gist. Camelot tells the story of King Arthur, at least the story from T.H. White's The Once and Future King, or at least the second, third and fourth stories of that adaptation. Sword in the Stone was left out, we'll leave Disney to do that one. The story is long and complex and convoluted, but in a nutshell, we have the slow but inevitable downfall of Arthur's marriage to Guinevere, alongside the slow but inevitable downfall of the entire kingdom. Merlin can see the future as well as the past, so he knows what's going to happen, which is why I said inevitable, but he can't remember whether he's told Arthur or not before he's out of the story completely. It takes place over God knows how many years. There's a love triangle, there's a plot to ruin the kingdom, and an ending that might seem happy compared to what happened in the climax, but really isn't any better. And a final little scene that reminds me of the end of The Last Jedi. But hey, JFK and Jackie Kennedy loved it. There was a lot of mess that happened behind the scenes. There were 2 months of tryout before it opened on Broadway. Alan J. Lerner's marriage was falling apart and he was under so much stress that he ended up being hospitalized. And right as he was leaving, Moss Hart was admitted because he had a heart attack. So people were rushing around like crazy trying to fill the shoes of the others who were MIA. In addition to that, they had to cut a lot. During the tryouts, the original runtime was 4.5 hours. By the time it got to Broadway, it had been edited down. But even in the first little while of it being on Broadway, they were still making pretty major changes. Take Me to the Fair, for example, was originally still in the show when it premiered on Broadway, but it was axed completely a short while in. It made it into the film, but more importantly, is still on the cast album. And thank goodness, because it's awesome. Julie, as you probably guessed, if you know anything about King Arthur at all, played Guinevere. Robert Goulet was playing Lancelot. Roddy McDowall played Arthur's illegitimate son, Mordred. Julie had seen him in My Friend Flicker as a child, and he was kind of her celebrity crush. In her memoir, she talks about how she used to write up all these title deeds for all the horses they owned and pretended they were married. So when they met the first time to do the show, she said, we're married, which is kind of adorable. And then as King Arthur was ever the ladies' man, Richard Burton. I mean, you know he's a ladies' man. He married Elizabeth Taylor. Twice. There was a bit of a running joke behind the scenes where everybody was going, I wonder who the king is screwing tonight. Because puns on song titles are funny. He told Julie that she was the only one of his leading ladies that he'd never slept with. I don't know if he was 100% serious or not, but Julie said, well, don't tell them that, it'll give me the worst reputation. So with all this, the end result was good. It wasn't even close to My Fair Lady. In her memoir, Julie said if it had come out before My Fair Lady, she thinks it would have done a lot better. She was nominated for a Tony for her performance, but she didn't win. A Tony is the only one of the EGOT she's missing. She was the only person in the company that got nominated but didn't win. It was nominated for Best Actor, Best Director, Best Costume Design, and Best Scenic Design, in addition to Julie, and they all won. But not her. So I talked about the boyfriend last year, and while it kind of started the chain reaction that got her to superstardom, Camelot was, in a way, the big one. You could argue that Camelot was Julie's most important stage role. She and Richard Burton performed What Do the Simple Folk Do on The Ed Sullivan Show, and it was watched by Dick and Bob Sherman and Don DeGrady, were all working on a little movie project. Maybe you've heard of it, Mary Poppins. So then Walt Disney himself came to see the show. He went backstage to Julie afterwards and pretty much signed her and her then husband Tony Bolton on the spot. So while My Fair Lady is probably her biggest stage role, Camelot was the one that got her to Hollywood. Camelot is a little hard for me to talk about my feelings on. Unlike most of the other videos in this series, I don't have anything to watch when it comes to Camelot. The only footage that exists, at least of Julie, are the couple of songs she did on the It's 11 show. I haven't seen it on the stage, and the movie was kind of a giant disaster. And that's not just a personal opinion. It was a disaster. Richard Harris was drunk the whole time, it was delayed and went over budget, and
that open-mouthed, vacant look that Vanessa Redgrave's got after a tea.
My dad actually showed me that skit like a week after I saw the movie. And I really only watched the movie to say I'd watched it and knew the plot. But I still didn't fully understand it after watching it, and I still don't fully understand it now. I mean, you heard the description I gave earlier. But I guess John Cleese mentioning Vanessa Redgrave is a good place to start. The biggest thing I have access to regarding Camelot is the album. One of the best parts, in my opinion, is the way Julie sings two particular songs, Take Me to the Fair and The Lusty Month of May. In the movie, they had to slow those two songs down to almost the point of yawn for Vanessa Redgrave, and in doing so, it lost all the really, really impressive bits.
I do applaud your noble goals. Now let us see if you achieve them. And if you do, then you will be the three who will go to the ball, to the show. See if you achieve them, and if you do, then you will be the free who will go to the ball, to the show, and take me to the fair.
Seriously, I doubt it could have saved the movie, but getting Marnie Nixon to dub her would not have been a bad idea. She already had the voice because Audrey. Actually, in all honesty, Marnie Nixon was treated pretty horribly by Hollywood regarding her dubbing, but that's another story. And I guess that's mostly what I can say about the show. I don't really know it as a show. Maybe it's just because the movie was so disastrous, but I was confused. I was confused watching the movie, so that didn't help. I haven't seen it on the stage, so all I have is the album. I know it is songs more than something with a concrete plot or anything visual. And the songs are truly wonderful. As I said, Lusty Month of May and Take Me to the Fair are incredible to listen to. Not just the fact that Julie's singing, but you can tell they're very complex pieces. Seven Deadly Virtues and I Wonder What the King is Doing Tonight are hilarious. Guinevere I find weirdly catchy, and What Do the Simple Folk Do is my ringtone. So, with only minimal footage of Julie, a stage presence that is very, very small, and a movie that was the production from hell, maybe it's best if I only know it as an album. And that's everything for today, guys. I hope you enjoyed. Let me know, what are your thoughts on Camelot? The stage version, the screen version, just the album, like me? Let me know. Also, what's your favourite song? Mine is definitely What Do the Simple Folk Do? I hope you guys are all staying safe. Feel free to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in my video next week. So long, bye-bye!